Hey, Dad.
Tweet with us 24/7 at the Sports Fix CLE.
Hey guys, football season's only just begun, but it already feels like the playoffs at DraftKings.com, America's favorite one-week fantasy football site. One-week fantasy at DraftKings means no season-long commitments. It's fantasy football on demand, just like the Sports Fix. Play where you want, when you want, with the players you want today. And with $1 million up for grabs every week, every game is the big game, and every play matters. So first and 10 in the first quarter feels like fourth and goal with just a second left, and in just a victory for your favorite team, it could mean ball into $1 million payday, my friend. This isn't fantasy as usual. This to the big time. Hurry to DraftKings to play for free for this weekend's millionaire free entry now on DraftKings.com.
Portions of the Sports Fix brought to you by Fantasy Jocks. Looking to upgrade your league trophy? Check out FantasyJocks.com for championship belts, rings, trophies, and more.
Live in Ohio, it's time to get your fix. The Sports Fix.
And away we go with the kickoff of the week here. Kick in the gut, kick in the week, kick of the week, whatever you want to call it. We're going to kick this bad boy off here. Getting launched and loaded on the Sports Fix. I'm just talking back and forth right now to my man, Dan Wismar, who's going to join us here in just a little bit to talk about all the things we're going to get into from this weekend. The Browns, the Buckeyes, the Indians, Cavaliers, media day today. So much going on, so much to talk about. Mondays, as always, means Dan Wismar is in the house with us. The phone lines are open. You guys are in the conversation, and we're kicking off another week here on the Sports Fix. Feeling good. I know it's hard for many of you to even broach feeling good today, and I get it, man. It was a I don't even know where to begin. Although I do. I've got a list here. I've got a chart. I've got points and counterpoints. I know where to begin. I just don't know why, but we're going to roll into it. We're going to talk about the Browns. Really, just it's not a matter of 27-20, in my opinion. It's not a matter of winning or losing, in my opinion. It's the manner in which it went down. It was just an ugly performance, a Bush League effort. Scout team, best words Mike Pettine could put out there from his defense. I don't lay this anywhere else. I don't lay this at the feet of the offense, which, in my opinion, overperformed what every one of you thought the preseason expectations was going to be. I'm just saying, you get 20 points a game out of this offense, consider yourself lucky. Consider yourself fortunate, because that's what this offense is built to give you at best. Come on. This is a low-powered offense, and you knew that going in. It was all about the running game. It was all about the defense, the revamped stopping the run. The running game got you 39 yards. The revamped run gave up. Oh, Latavius Murray went to town. Listen, and I've got to introduce the show. We'll get into the X's and O's and all of that stuff. When a fullback, 55, do you even know the name of the Browns fullback? Many of you don't. Most teams, not exactly the most popular player on the team. It's Michael Johnson, by the way, for the Browns. Most popular player on the team, not necessarily the fullback. They're quiet. They're low key. They don't do much. They especially don't break off 55-yard pass returns, where 54 and a half of it came after the reception. I mean, when Marcel Reese broke that pass, I'm looking around the room of people as we're watching the game, and I'm going, this is the fullback. This is the big ugly on offense. This is an offensive lineman in disguise. It's the reason he's the fullback, and he has just rumbled down half of the field, guys. We're going to get into that here in just a moment. Again, I don't think Mike Pettine could have used a better term other than scout team, and to me, I'll just start off leaving this hanging out there, and we'll get into the introduction of the show. You had three games this season, and I'm very curious where Dan Wismar checks in with us when he joins me just about 20 minutes from now. I want to see if he agrees with this assessment through three games. I mean, you can look at it however you want. I'll continue to say that I like pieces of this team better than I have in a while. But as a whole, as a scheme, as the way it's being put together, absolutely not. And I believe in three games, you can say that game two. To me, this is not a good team who looked bad yesterday. That's not what they looked like. That's not the way they lost. They didn't lose in the manner of a good team that had a bad game. And that's exactly the same way I felt after week one. Meanwhile, week two, I think it may have been more a case of a bad team looking good than the vice versa. And we'll talk about that here in just a minute. A lot to get into. Larry, excellent comment. If this keeps up, I don't care if you like Mike Pettine. I love Mike Pettine as a head coach until things like this happen, because the buck does have to stop with him. I love Mike Pettine. I've said this. I've thought he was my favorite Browns coach probably since Marty. You know, I mean, I've really liked a lot of the things that he's done, but the buck does stop with the head coach. I mean, you can say this guy, and he doesn't throw people under the bus. Even if privately you're saying, man, Jim O'Neill, what happened with the defense? Hey, Chris Tabor, what happened with your special teams? Hey, what happened with this, that, and the other thing? The buck does stop there at the end of the day. And I do think that this is part of where you're seeing so much on the plate of the head coach, with the general manager being persona non grata, with all of the things that have been going on. Mike Pettine handling a lot of being the front and center on all of this stuff. And to me, sometimes you focus too much on too many things and not enough on the important things, like making sure your team is out there and ready to play. That's day one stuff we're talking about here. Whether you like the Browns, dislike the Browns, whether you think they're good, bad, indifferent, it doesn't matter. That's day one stuff right there. And at the end of the day, I have to say, Larry is quite on with that comment. If this type of performances, the effort showing up, if that continues, Mike Pettine's going to be running somebody else's scout team. It's meant as a joke, but unfortunately, it means the truth of what many of us fear. I mean, I think even if you dislike Mike Pettine, I think you must dislike the idea of switching the regimes this quickly again, even more, because I'd almost rather stay stable. Then again, somebody will yell at me right now and go, oh, okay, hey, keep a bad coach in place just to keep somebody. Yes, keep somebody in place for a while, something, accidentally. Every once in a while, you plant a seed, it doesn't grow right away, you keep watering it. One day there's a tree there, and you go, where did that come from? Oh, we forgot all about that seed. And so instead of moving on, it just went, it was able to grow on its own. That never will happen here. Nothing can grow on its own. But anyways, that's moving too far down the rabbit hole there. Point being is, from the top down, unacceptable effort. Defense takes all of the fault in this one. If you're going to start this argument, this conversation, and this show with the words Johnny Manziel, save it. Save it for somebody else. Save it for another day, because I don't care if Christopher Reeves himself flew in faster than a speeding bullet. He wasn't saving this one. He wasn't saving this. The superhero wasn't winning this one. It had nothing to do with who was running the ship at the quarterback position yesterday for the Cleveland Browns. Let's do it. Let's get into all of it. We got plenty more than just the Browns to talk about. A whole slate of NFL games. Wow, some video game performances yesterday around the league. AJ Green, I mean, several guys with big multiple touchdown days. We'll get into all of that. Talk about the Buckeyes and their win heading into Big Ten schedule time, Indians, so much more. We've got Dan Wismar from Everybody Hates Cleveland joining us in just about 20 minutes, less than that, 15 minutes from now. We're going to crack the phones and we're going to do the thing as we kick off another week. Welcome in, my friends, to the Sports Fix. I am your host, the Big Daddy on the microphone, and I'm going to have a good time today. I know it's hard. We're going to find a way to enjoy the conversation the best we can as we kick off another week, because that's what we do here on the Sports Fix. We try to do it just a little bit different, a little bit outside the box here from everybody else, although days like yesterday damn sure make it hard on us. I hear you and I feel your pain, that's for sure. Hey, feel better. The Cavaliers are actually bouncing basketballs today. I know it's just for cameras, but that that means basketballs are coming. So if anything, put that in your back pocket as we roll. Welcome in, Sports Fix. I'm your host, the Big Daddy on the microphone. They call me J-Rock, Jerry Myers. Call me happy to have you here each and every day, live at noon Eastern, when we kick this thing off across the Sports Fix Radio Network. Whether you're joining us live on TuneIn, TuneIn's radio app, Spreaker, Mixler, their respective websites, digital apps, mobile apps, all great places to listen to the show, as many of you are doing right now, live, right here, right now. Many of you as well listening live on our website, the home base, thesportsfix.net. That's right, Bruce. Tomorrow, those basketballs, that training camp starts for real, as the kids nowadays would say. As well, welcome in those of you listening live on thesportsfix.net, our home base. Bookmark it if you haven't. It's a great backup site to listen to the show live anytime it's on the air. Catch our replays, social media widgets, everything right there. I almost gave you the Facebook. Yeah, thesportsfix.net as well. Hit a thank you, all of you guys, for hitting us up 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, live on digital delay. Such a huge part of our audience. Thousands of you guys that listen daily on sites such as iHeartRadio, the world's largest internet radio provider, on iTunes, on Stitcher Radio, on CarPlay, on all of the various smaller sites and the podcasting places that you download us, feed us, subscribe to us, do all of the technical nonsense that allows you to get your fix. I thank you guys. I say it all the time. Thank you so much. And something I don't say enough of, I'm going to just jump in quickly. Hey, tell somebody else if you like what you're listening to right now. Do me a favor, while we're doing this whole introduction spiel, click share on your Spreaker, your Mixler, your TuneIn, your iHeartRadio, wherever it is. They've all got a little share button right now on whatever you're listening to. Give that a click. Send it out across your social media, on your Facebook, on your Twitter, and tell somebody else, hey, I'm getting my fix with J-Rock Daddy, as LG would say. Come on in and get your fix with us, and invite your friends to come in and enjoy what we do and keep this thing growing, you guys, as we keep this thing going. And get your fix and be a part of the show. Talking about that social media, use it. Facebook, Twitter, email. Let me know your thoughts. They've been coming in all night and all morning about the Browns and about all the things from the weekend. Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. Twitter at TheSportsFix, CLE. Email TheSportsFix@AOL.com. Or you could pick up the phone and give us a call. 216-539-7535. 216-539-7535. Again, Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. Twitter at TheSportsFix, CLE. Email TheSportsFix@AOL.com. Or pick up the phone, give us a call. Your take on the Browns, on the Buckeyes, on the Tribe, on anything you'd like. Although I'm pretty sure the Browns is where we're at right now. 216-539-7535. And remember, guys, that is a 24-hour hotline, so you can hit us up anytime with your thoughts on anything that's going on. And I'm just going to jump right back into the conversation. Dan Wismar, Everybody Hates Cleveland's going to be with us 10 minutes from now. We'll get the first break in. We'll get Dan jumping right in on this conversation. And once Dan joins us, we'll shut down the phones. As a matter of fact, may not even be able to get too much in here before that. We'll definitely fire him up here throughout the remainder of the show, because I know a lot of you guys have a lot to talk about here. And Dan's going to be with us early and then jump off early, so it'll open up some time in the back half of the show as well for me to jump in on the phone lines. And I'm going to jump right back in on what we were saying as we kicked off the show, and I'll go back to those words, scout team. I'll say Bush League, and I'll throw it out defensively particularly. I mean, there were so many instances in yesterday's Browns game, and to me, 27-20 doesn't do it justice. The final score, you know, being a play away, and I will give the Browns credit, by the way, for that final drive, coming down the field, because the situation that put them there is one of the three, to me, the three keys to that game, besides even going beyond making keys to the game. I mean, 300, 100, 100. There's your biggest key to the game. 300, 100, 100. And that is the split that every team dreams for offensively at the end of a game in the box score. and the Browns gave it up yesterday, the trifecta, as in more than 300 yards for the quarterback, David Carr, 100 yards rushing, and a 100-yard receiver, and that would be Latavius Murray and Cooper. Oh, man, did Cooper, he buttered up and burnt Joe Hayden like breakfast toast all over the field, and I'm sorry, to me, that's week after week after week of Joe Hayden. I mean, as Mike Pettine put it, that's good against good. That's your best and our best matched up and going out there. And as nicely as Mike Pettine wants to say, well, they made the plays. They got it done at the end of the day. To me, that sums up everything that needs to be said about Joe Hayden. I don't dislike Joe Hayden. You guys know that. I do think that he's a very serviceable NFL cornerback. I in no way believe that he's anybody's lockdown cornerback, especially in today's NFL. He's undersized. He plays well within his skill set, and there are certain wide receivers that he matches up well with and that he is able to defend well, and I'll give him that. But I mean, as we've seen, there is a certain skill level and a certain size and a certain prototype of wide receiver that continually has their way with Joe Hayden. And that is the bottom line of it. And we saw it again with Armani Cooper. And you know what we saw? And really, I was talking to some guys. I was in a group of 10, 12 guys watching the game yesterday, which is always great market research for having a think tank of things going on to bounce off as we're coming in here and doing the show. And one of the things is, I said, because, you know, of course you get, and we talked about this last week, you got, it seems like every game, you're going to have the ghosts of who the Browns could have drafted and didn't. And the reason you're going to always hear that is because they draft so poorly that almost every team in the NFL has got two or three guys on it that you can say, well, the Browns passed that guy, and they passed that guy, and wouldn't that guy look good? So it's almost always going to be a self-fulfilling, the ghosts of the Browns non-draft coming back to get them. You saw it again here today with some of those names I mentioned, Derek Carr. I mean, Cooper, not so, you would have had to at least make a move to get him, but you could have simply walked away with Derek Carr. With Khalil Mack, who was an absolute force defensively. Watching him play, guys, was he not amazing to watch Mack out there yesterday? The way a linebacker, you forget about it here because we don't have it. We have guys who get drafted in the first round so they can learn how to drop back and cover because they can't get to the quarterback. No disrespect, but I mean, watching a linebacker able to freely affect another team's game plan the way Khalil Mack was able to yesterday. And you notice I could pronounce his name correctly. I don't get paid hundreds of thousands of dollars a year to be a professional broadcaster. God, those guys on television are awful. That was just one of my many complaints about yesterday's game. But anyways, good comment too, Larry. Going back to Joe Hayden, Aqib Talib, if you watch the way he was matching up in that game last night with Calvin Johnson, and that was a matchup of good versus good, Mike Pettine, of best versus best. And each one won some battles. Aqib Talib stopped some, and Calvin Johnson stopped some. And Calvin Johnson took an interception away, and Talib knocked a pass away that should have been caught. And that was mano a mano. That was watching two pros and two of the best at their craft do what they do. To me, that was some good stuff. I'm referring to the Sunday night game last night. But going back to the ghosts of the Browns past, you're going to get that. You're going to constantly have that because I've said it yesterday. Just about every team is going to have two or three guys that you go, well, they passed up on that guy. They passed up on that guy. And then they come back and get you. And you saw that again. I had somebody yesterday message me and say, oh, well, you know, you look at the final stats and Carr and McCown, and I'm not, hey, I don't blame McCown. I do believe that there was a couple passes he could have thrown better, of course, a couple of off passes and things like that. But he was fine. He was, if you expect more than what you got yesterday out of McCown, then you're crazy. And I've got to talk to you about some things because I got some land to sell you somewhere. I don't even have it yet, but I'll acquire it and sell it to you at a profit because there's no way. That is, if you get what you got yesterday out of Josh McCown every day, call yourself a winner. Go to the casino because you cashed out. That's your high point. That's fine. That's what it's going to be at that level of quarterback. So nobody can lay the blame there. Absolutely, Bruce. Passed on Carr not once but twice. And I say, would you not like to have that young man back behind at quarterback? Because I watched some of those throws that he made, and they're very highly skilled throws. He's a very good quarterback. He's going to be, I believe, a good quarterback here, and I think he could be what finally is that light at the end of the tunnel for the Raiders, who've got a lot of good talent in a lot of good places. I don't think they're as good as they looked against the Browns. I clearly will say that, but they definitely have some pieces. I mean, think about it. They didn't get a sack in the first two games of the season, and they couldn't stay out of the Browns' backfield yesterday. I believe they officially had five and were just all over the place on many other shots as well. The Browns' rushing game, nothing, 39 yards. I mean, they're not that stout because they were destroyed in the first two games of the season. And that, to me, speaks more against the Browns than it does for the Raiders. Although, again, I don't want to take away from what they did as well. I mean, Khalil Mack was just a force in the backfield constantly. And the opposite can be said. Look at the opposite. You know, same level draft pick, Barkevious Mingo, a few years ago. His highlight from yesterday is getting carried into the end zone by Latavius Murray. Just carried into the end zone. Latavius Murray, he outdid the Browns' rushing production yesterday by 100 yards by himself. And it just, again, not stopping the run, not stopping the pass. Let's get that fallacy out of the way as well. It wasn't just the ability not to stop the run. It's the ability not to stop the pass, not to make tackles. I go back to Marcel Reese. I'll wait. You guys hit me up. The next 55-yard pass reception you recall from a fullback anywhere. And I know you'll find one eventually, but it's going to take you some time, that's for sure. I mean, that was ridiculous. You know how it happened? Because the Browns busted their own tackle. Dante Whitner came in and decided to try to de-cleat the guy in the middle of the tackle already being executed and instead blows it up. And next thing you know, dude, if he didn't run out of gas, the Browns are lucky he was a fullback, because if he was any other kind of a back, he would have been in the back of the end zone with a touchdown. He was a fullback, and so he lost gas about 50 yards into that thing, and I think he even tackled himself. Where was Chris Berman? Because he was a rumbling, bumbling, stumbling, and 55 yards later, Marcel Reese becoming the hot fantasy football pickup next week. Let me just advise you now, you don't need to talk to B.J. Riddell. Unless they're playing the Browns, leave Marcel Reese in the waiver wires, because he's going to end this season with 55 yards receiving. That'll be the one and only highlight there. But tons of highlights everywhere offensively for Oakland against the Cleveland Browns defense. And this is the second time in three games that this defense absolutely showed up and laid an egg. And that's where I go back to what I said. I think it's less of week two. Oh, well, this is the Browns we thought they were going to be. I think that was more of a bad team showing up and having a good game, which happens three or four times a season, no matter who you are and who you're playing. And I think at least as of what we're seeing, games one and games three are indicative of what we've got. And that's a team that, I don't know, maybe believes their own. I laugh when I think to the secondary here. And then again, going at picks, there's Justin Gilbert, who can't even get on the field. You know, meanwhile, Charles Woodson. There's another one there's so many people that I watch, and I remember conversations that we've had during free agency time, during other times, about players. And Michael Crabtree's one that was mocked. Charles Woodson, Grandpa, old man Woodson, yet he makes the play of the game at the end to seal things off, you know. And you look at Khalil Mack doing his thing for the Raiders defensively, and Justin Gilbert. There's another bad strike against the Browns defensively and drafting-wise, and in that whole area is you see that. You got Quan Williams down. You got Joe Hayden goes down. You got everybody in the backfield banged up yesterday and going down, and there wasn't room for Justin Gilbert. And I'm not saying this in a bad way. Clearly, there's something to discuss there as well. And So those are all issues defensively. That's the side of the ball where the balance is supposed to lay. That's the side of the ball where you're supposed to be able to say, this is what we're building on. We'll fix the offense as it gets there. You can't find a quarterback overnight. Cool. I get it. The defense was roasted and toasted, and it was effort from the very beginning. You made some stops, and then, and you know what? We'll pick this up when we come back. But, you know, on top of everything else, on top of, in general, playing poorly, I can look at 3 points of this game. To me, it's very easy if you watch this game. And let's just forget that, because basically every NFL game, I'm just saying, 90% of them, they're always within a touchdown or 10 points in the fourth quarter. So there's always a chance for a team to win. It's the way the NFL is built. It's parity in the game, out of the game, all the way around. And the big keys, though, all bad against the Browns. It's all self-inflicted, and this is what scares me because it goes to coaching. And I would be willing to say I'm going to lean back on Mike Pettine being overextended with many of the hats that he's wearing here, and perhaps overlooking the most important ones, the final details, the things that a head coach should be worried about, when instead he's got 57 brush fires to put out all week long on top of trying to do his thing. And that's still making excuses for players that just plain and simple didn't show up to play when they needed to show up to play. But my 3 turning points in the game, we're going to hit the break. We'll get the news. We'll get Dan Wismar in on this, and we'll pick up from there and talk more Browns, talk all the rest of the NFL action and all the things still. Cavs, Indians, Tristan Thompson, tons to get into with Dan Wismar. My 3 turning points of the game. What are yours? To me, the end of the first half, absolutely huge. Here you had an opportunity. You had 4 cracks at the freaking goal line to begin with. You're unable to get the score. You've got the 4th-and-1. Chance to get the touchdown. Chance to make it 10-7 there. Or at the very least, which they get the field goal there, 10-3. Take it to the half and say, okay, let's regroup and redo this thing. You get the penalty. You botch your play. No touchdown. You end up having to settle for the field goal. Okay, let's regroup at halftime. No. With what? Less than 90 seconds on the clock, you let Oakland just stream down on you. Big play, touchdown, and you're stunned and shell-shocked heading into the half down a boatload of points instead of having a much closer swing and then coming out in the second half with some momentum and feeling decent about yourself. To me, that was huge. As much the stop and the field goal, but even more, right immediately, boom, 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 right down the field. You're thinking, here comes halftime. Oakland's like, no, there's plenty of time left on this clock. Huge swinging point of the game. The other two, both special teams. And Chris Tabor, I don't care. Every once in a while, Travis Benjamin may bail you out and make you look good with a punt return, but he's the worst special teams coach in the NFL. First, these guys acted like here we go with the Team Bush League again. These guys acted like a bunch of third graders on their first little dalliance with a girl, and they're holding hands, and they're getting a little shy kiss. Listen, these guys instead tried to trample the flowers. They tried to bum rush the playground. You go for the block punt. Now, it's bad enough when you touch the kicker. Bad enough when one guy makes the mistake. Okay, that's a bad enough penalty. Your whole freaking defensive line tackled the punter. I mean, they were all just so happy. Gotta get to the punter. Let's all tackle him and make it the easiest roughing the kicker penalty in the history of the NFL. And instead of getting a turnover right there, you give the first down back to the team. You allow Oakland. What did they do? They came down the field with ease, like a knife through butter. They came, 5 plays in a row? Boom, 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 touchdown. Dude, what was that? What was that? All because 17 guys had to go try to block the punter and run into him at the That's what made me mad as they showed the replay. I'm like, I can get it. I get mad enough when one guy does it. 4 of you at the same time ran into the punter. That's undisciplined. That's stupid. That is undisciplined football. cost yourself a big swing in momentum right there. And the biggest one, Travis Benjamin. For all the talk of Travis Benjamin, first Brown to score touchdowns in the first three games, all the, I don't care about that. Travis Benjamin, at the end of the day, that muffed punt. Think of the swing of the game. The Browns hold, three and out, force a punt. There's 5 minutes, or 4.5 minutes to go in the game. And you've got a chance to get the ball and win this game. Here comes the punt. Or excuse me, here comes the punt. Travis Benjamin, midfield. You would have only had 45 yards to cover. Boom. Fumbles the punt, picked up by the Raiders. What happens next? Three and out again by your defense. So you make one more stop. Here comes the next punt that gets downed on the half-yard line. And instead of first down on the 45 or so with about 45 yards to go and 4.5 minutes and three timeouts and a partridge in a pear tree to go down and make Christmas dinner, instead, you end up at the 99.5 yards to go line with 2 minutes left in the game and a couple of timeouts left. And they still, hey, that I will say, and this is why I'll say, get off Josh McCown. I don't want to hear it. He drove that team all the way down the field. That was an impressive drive at the end. He made three or four big plays, big throws on that drive. There was the one big one on a big third and long. They got out of two big third and longs on that drive. The Hartline catch was big. There was another one to Hawkins, and there was the Duke Johnson, where Duke Johnson got a lot of yardage on his own off after that one. But still, you had all of those, and a good drive. A good drive with a bad final pass and a final outcome, but it doesn't matter. Again, if you think that's why they lost, you're lost, my friend. If you think Johnny, Josh, Brian, I don't care, Derek, Brandon, Charlie, Joe Schmo, all of them, Otto Graham wasn't winning that game yesterday the way that defense played. Not Bernie, not none of them. We'll talk about it when we come back. Let's take a break, catch our breath. Here comes the news. Here comes Dan Wismar, and we'll talk more about the Browns and this latest, whatever you want to call it, at the hands of the Raiders, who can't beat anybody on the road except the Cleveland Browns. Derek Carr's now got three career 300-yard games, two of them against the Cleveland Browns. Go figure. We'll talk about that. Talk Buckeyes, Browns, Indians, Cavaliers, Tristan Thompson, and more with Dan Wismar from the Cleveland Fan and Everybody Hates Cleveland, coming up next right after the news here on the Sports Fix. Don't go anywhere, baby. We'll be right back.
The Sports Fix, the show that asks the question,
what you talking about, Lou? What you talking about, Lou? What you talking about? What you talking about? What you talking about, Lou? What you talking about? What you talking about, Lou?
We'll be right back.
Hey guys, before we go to the break, I want to talk to you a little bit again about our good friends at Harry Buffalo North Olmsted, the UFC, the Ultimate Fighting Championships, some of the hottest fights in the world today. Each and every one of their huge events, Harry Buffalo is one of the few places in Northeast Ohio you can go there and watch each and every UFC fight at the Harry Buffalo. And let me tell you, I've been there. The people are out the door. They are to the rafters. It is one of the craziest environments for some UFC fights. Wing Mondays, they've got great deals on wings and drinks. And every day of the week, there's a different special, a different deal. And don't forget the Bison Burger, the unbelievable. It is the combination of a fantastic burger and eating healthy combined into one unbelievable sandwich. You have got to get a Bison Burger while you're there. So whatever you're looking for, whatever day of the week, Monday through Friday, Saturday, Sundays, there's something for you at the Harry Buffalo North Olmsted, just outside Great Northern Mall. Check them out today. Harry Buffalo, join the herd.
Hello, Cleveland. This is WWE Hall of Famer Mick Foley, and you are listening to the Sports Fix. Yeah.
I'm Little Teapot, short and stout.
Here is my handle and here is my spout.
No, Dad, like this. When I get all steamed up, then I shout, tip me over and
pour me out.
This is WWE superstar Roman Reigns. The smallest moments can have the biggest impact on a child's life. Take time to be a dad today.
Visit fatherhood.gov, brought to you by the U.S. Department of Health and Human Services and the Ad Council.
Fantasy sports lovers, you put so much time, hard work, and effort into playing week to week that it quickly stops being a fantasy and starts getting real. And when the smoke clears, you want to show off those victories with a real prize.
I mean, a really real prize.
Nobody does that like Fantasy Jocks. The crew over at Fantasy Jocks have beautiful, high-quality, and heavy-duty championship belts, rings, trophies, and so much more for all your fantasy sports needs. There's literally only one place to go. FantasyJocks.com.
Whether it's an oil change or a new set of tires, Quick Lane at Valley Ford Truck has you covered for your car care needs. They're your neighborhood quick service experts. They also offer a low price tire guarantee. Choose from 13 brands, and if you find the same tires at a lower price within 30 days, Quick Lane at Valley Ford will refund the difference. 5715 Canal Road, right under the 480 Bridge in Valley View. Come see why life is better in the Quick Lane. QuickLane.com/Valley Ford Truck.
Portions of the Sports Fix brought to you by Harry Buffalo. Harry Buffalo, join the herd.
News break.
Good morning, I'm Bob Picozzi. The official word from the Steelers, no timetable for Ben Roethlisberger's return. ESPN's Adam Schefter is reporting that sources indicate Pittsburgh expects to be without Roethlisberger for as long as 6 weeks. He sprained the MCL in his left knee in yesterday's win over St. Louis. So the job now belongs to 35-year-old Michael Vick. ESPN NFL front office insider Lewis Riddick, a guest today on Mike and Mike.
They're just going to have to try and force it into him, the fact that we've got a pretty good football team here. We just need you to not lose the game. Don't give it to the other team. It's tough, but he's going to have to somehow adjust his game so he doesn't put the rest of the team in jeopardy.
Vick's first start comes Thursday night against Baltimore. The Packers have won their last 10 games at home. They'll try to extend the streak tonight against Kansas City in Monday Night Football, 8:30 Eastern time on ESPN. The Toronto Raptors announced this morning they have signed free agent forward Anthony Bennett. He became the first Canadian-born player selected with the first pick of the NBA draft in 2013. And according to ESPN and media reports, 2016 will be Tony Stewart's final year as a full-time Sprint Cup driver.
At Buffalo Wild Wings, you could be instantly football rich. We're talking delicious wings, wall-to-wall TVs, catching all the football action, and cold beers on draft. Act now, and B-dubs will even throw in wet naps. Buffalo Wild Wings. Wings, beer, sports. Drink responsibly.
You're listening to The Sports Fix.
Hey man, if they're gonna make me feel like I'm stuck in a clown show I can't get out of, I'm at least gonna enjoy it and play some funky disco music with it, some YMCA. I felt like I was watching the Village People yesterday. And you guys know, hey, I'm pretty fair, man. I'm more than fair. I ride the front end of the bus better than the back, man. I like the positive side better than the opposite side, man. But it's not about making cute jokes or trying to pop the internet with a fancy line that somebody retweets or taking cheap shots, man. It's a plain and simple a matter of the effort that squad put out there yesterday. I mean, plain and simple. I mean, it could be worse. It could be Baltimore. It could be 0-3 for the first time ever. See, I'm not even there. Other people's downs don't fix your own, you know? Although you could be Baltimore. You could Pittsburgh. Pittsburgh is in they could be a lot worse, though. I think they're breathing easy this morning knowing that they may only be without their quarterback for about half the season. Yeah, well, imagine what it's like to go the whole season without one. Then multiply that by 15, because we've been 15 years without one. But you know what? Again, I had some guys hit me up in a break here. Jason Cato says, McCown sucks. If the Browns keep him in, they're going to go 1-15. Well, hold up. I'll go back to my Christopher Reeves. I'll go back to his dad. I'll go back to any incarnation of Superman you want, any superhero. Go get me your brooding Batman, whoever. I don't know if any quarterback can prevent this squad from going 1-15 when they went 1-3 through this part of the schedule, and you've got the true schedule, the beast, the teeth, the tough part of this thing still to come with some very good teams that even if you were a good football team from top to bottom, we would be talking about this right here. You know what I mean? Like, if the Browns were a wild card contender, we would still be sitting here going, boy, this is one heck of a tough schedule the Browns are getting ready to go through. This is make or break on the season. Now imagine doing it with what we've got. So, you know, but don't even tell me, because I love Jason. Good, he's always commenting, always interacting with the show on Facebook and Twitter and all that. But I disagree. No matter who it is, that's not going to have anything to do with whether or not this team wins another game the rest of the way. And I'm interested. If you're in that opinion, if you're in that belief listening right now, tell me why you think that Josh McCown is the reason that the Browns lost yesterday's game. And this isn't to say that I don't believe as well that we can't have the conversation about, well, if they're going to go 1-15, do you just throw Manziel to the Wolves and see if he can sink or swim? I'm not going to argue that, because I get that point too. Although, if the Browns don't go that way, what does that say? Let's pick all this up there with my man Dan Wismar. 216-539-7535. When you leave a take on the hotline, facebook.com/thesportsfix, Twitter at thesportsfixcle. Where are you at on all of that? I want to see where my man Dan Wismar is. Dan, how you doing, my friend?
I'm okay, Jerry, all things considered. It was a tough day yesterday down at the old ballpark, but you know, there were times in that first half, J-Rock, when I was embarrassed to be there. I was embarrassed to be a season ticket holder of the team. I was hoping that the team, that the players were embarrassed with their own performance. That's how bad it was. That's how depressing it was to see just boneheaded mistakes really cost them the game. And like you, you can point to two or three situations in that first half, you know, that cost them the game. They lost that game in the second quarter. They didn't lose it any other time. They lost that game by failing to score from first and goal at the one. They lost that game by roughing the punter, which prolonged what turned out to be the first touchdown drive for the Raiders. And then they lost the game in the last minute of the first half after they kicked a meager field goal. And like you say, watched a bing, bam, boom, three plays down the field, touchdown. And, you know, then almost gave it back again with 14 seconds to go if I'm ready to kick off. So some miserable special teams play, some unbelievably bad tackling display, some lack of play calling creativity on the 1 yard line, and just lack of some fundamental physical football, you know, tools. Took us back to 99 when it was routine for us to have first and goal on the 1 yard line and fail to score. It was embarrassing, and no amount of comeback in the second half and no amount of rally and finally got the crowd back into the game halfway through the fourth quarter, no amount of that could shake me out of my depression about what I was watching all afternoon. So that's my quick take.
And I'm with you. I mean, all of that. Even if the Browns pull that game out, let's say right now we're talking 28-27 Browns win, that everything that we're saying now would still apply to that thing that we saw yesterday. And I'm with you. The whole thing from the beginning, this team came out and just just lay down from the get. I mean, come on, man. I mean, I'll go back to what I could only imagine the reactions around you. And I go back to this play because I think I'll be talking about this one 5 years from now. When Marcel Reese rumbled and stumbled 55 yards down the field. I mean, have you ever seen a fullback break a pass 55 yards before, man? I swear I don't remember one. It's been a while.
No, I don't. And obviously he had some effective downfield blocking.
Yes, of course.
It was a matter of Gibson, and I don't know who the other tackler was.
Whitner.
Knocking each other.
It was
off
Gibson
the guy.
And Whitner. They bumped into each other there and screwed it up.
And you know, fluky in that regard, except for it's not fluky when you can't tackle all day long. It's not, you know, their failure to tackle him was not the exception to the rule.
It was the rule
on the day. We weren't wrapping up. We weren't tackling. And, yes, that's Mike Pettine, and that's Mike Pettine's specialty. He's in charge of the defense. It just was depressing, Jerry, because, you know, I said to the guy next to me, who's been sitting next to me for 16 years now, in the Section 129, Row 2, that I said, I hope that McCown doesn't start slow. I hope McCown, you know, this is before the opening kickoff. I hope he doesn't start slow because you know what will happen. It'll be the middle of the first quarter, and we'll be hearing the Johnny chant from the fans. And that's exactly what happened, not only the slow start, as McCown, as well as he threw the ball later on to the tune of 300-plus yards, he did start slow. He was inaccurate. He missed several throws. He was really off, and he's almost looked like a guy who hadn't played for 2 weeks.
Absolutely.
And maybe got his bell rung last time he was on the football field. And so, you know, and sure enough, like, you know, night follows day, there was the Johnny chant coming up. I don't know if you could hear it on the TV feed or not, but it was there. And anytime you saw someone in the Browns offensive huddle like Alex Mack, you know, do the hands down gesture, arms out, hands down, like quiet down, it was strictly because the Johnny chant was coming out, and they didn't want to hear it. They wanted to tamp it down. And so Mack and Joe Thomas were doing the, you know, the quiet down gesture.
Hold on. Think about that. It is for everybody that thinks this stuff is cute and these players just cash their checks and none of this stuff matters and all of this stuff. You've got the crowd having fun at the expense of the players and chanting for a kid who is not in the game. And you got the players in the huddle telling the crowd to shut up. I mean, think about that dynamic right there, Dan.
Yeah, well, that might be distressing, but, you know, there were a lot of us sitting in the stands who also wanted the fans to shut up. In other words, it's the last thing this team needs right now, and certainly in that moment, with Johnny Manziel to be on the field, you know, regardless of the fact that McCown had some inaccurate throws, missed some people, whether they were open, whether it would have resulted in big yardage, who knows. But he overthrew some balls. He had maybe six or eight really bad throws in the first half that a better throw would have helped the offense move and picked up a first down. But none of that means that it would have been better to have Johnny on the field, and I know you're with me on that.
Absolutely.
You know, Josh McCown wasn't the reason they lost a game.
It was all
on the defense and special teams. The other thing, J-Rock, that I was hoping to see was, you know, guys say, you know, we always show up there at the, you know, in our section with the usual suspects all around us saying, you know, hey, so what do you think? You know, before the kickoff, what do you think? And what I thought and what I, you know, said was, you know, I hope that the team can come out with the same kind of emotion and the same kind of up energy that we saw last week with Tennessee. They didn't. It's unexplainable to me. It's unfathomable to me how they can take the field. And we are looking at each other like, how can this team be so flat? You've got a quarterback who didn't play last week and who's rusty, obviously, and misfiring. But how can you come out emotionless in front of a crowd that was pretty much jacked up at the beginning and ready to roll? And our own team took us out of the game as a crowd. It was unbelievable.
I agree with everything you're talking about. Dan Wismar from Everybody Hates Cleveland joining us, and we're talking about the Browns. And I'll go back to the quarterback thing. And this is just my own personal take. And I absolutely had the feeling that you did. And for what it's worth, man, I agree about McCown with the slow start to the game, and he definitely played better in the second half. But matter of fact, before I even get into what I thought about Manziel and if he would have played, with especially the way that defense was playing, I don't know if you heard in my open, but I was talking about the overall of this game, and I said, while y'all are throwing out blame, and if Johnny would have played and McCown that, what Josh McCown yesterday, overall stats and career high in yardage and all of that, and the good that you got, the bad, the ugly, all of that. Same thing with 20 points out of the Browns offense. That is your happy place this season. It's not like they dressed you going into the season that if you got more than 20 points a game out of place, because that's where you were going to be hanging out, and it was up to your defense to keep teams under that point. Same thing with quarterback. If you get 16, well, however many is left now, but if you get 16 performances like yesterday out of Josh McCown, you won when you rolled the dice on Josh McCown as your veteran quarterback, because that's about as good as it's going to get. Am I wrong?
Oh, no, absolutely not. And, you know, to hold the other team to 20 or whatever, we didn't hold them to 20, but, you know, I hear what you're saying. The other thing that's profoundly depressing to me is, and you alluded to it earlier, and you know that pre-draft last year,
yes,
I was a big Derek Carr guy. You
yes,
know,
you were.
I liked him, and I was a voice in the wilderness. I know you liked him too, but
I liked Bridgewater, you know, more. But I did like Carr. I did like Carr number yeah. two. He was my number two guy.
Right, but to see him, and then to see other NFL teams who somehow got the memo that big, tall, athletic wide receivers like Amari Cooper, like Michael
Man.
Crabtree, and all these other cats, that's what you need. We have zero of those on our roster. Not that we haven't had a chance to draft them. And again, won't rehash the whole could have had Sammy Watkins, Derek
right.
Carr thing, even
right.
though I just rehashed it. But those are the things that get me down as I'm watching the team. And you know, Ray Farmer's had now two drafts in order to try to acquire or draft and develop what some people call playmakers on offense. We don't have the running back that's a playmaker. We don't have the wide receiver that's a playmaker. We don't have the quarterback that's a playmaker. That's what other teams have that are successful in the NFL. We don't have them. We consistently avoid getting them, and we draft a fourth round Vince Maley and cut him. So those kinds of things, as far as the outlook looking forward, is also depressing to me, because next year Ray Farmer will be drafting for us by you know, most accounts, and you know, with the input from Mike Pettine, the guy that took Justin Gilbert. So I'm just not feeling real good about the short or long-term future right now for this franchise, because it's 16 years now and I'm getting old.
Hey, Dan, on top of that, and I don't want to start this now in week three, but there's plenty of people that have started this earlier than I did. If this team plays, and I'm not even going to say all the rest of their games, the way they played yesterday and the way they played in week one, if they even show up a half a dozen more times as lame effort-wise and passion-wise as they did, I don't think anybody survives this season. And I'm talking Mike Pettine and I'm talking Ray Farmer, because I don't care if Jimmy says he's going to wait. I believe that there is a certain level of failure that will be okay. Like, I believe if they can get to five wins, if they can get there somehow with what's left on this schedule, and you've missed the opportunity to win two that could have been on that list there. If they can get to five or six, we're not having this conversation. But if they play as poorly as they did, and we're talking about two, three wins this season, I don't know that any of them survive, which is the worst thing to me. Even if you heard me at the beginning, even if you say, I don't like Mike Pettine, he's an idiot, or I don't like Ray Farmer, I'm in the point where I'm wondering, is it better to stick with somebody you don't like just for the sake of sticking with them for a while, or because I think those are the conversations that may be in the offing here, and I'm talking effort-wise. If they come out flat, I mean, what do you do? I like Mike Pettine. You like Mike Pettine. But who else do you lay it at the feet of? And I wonder, you heard what I was alluding to earlier, with Mike Pettine kind of also being front and center with the media because there's no Ray Farmer and there's nobody media-wise that's answering Ray Farmer's questions. It's not like the other general manager de facto guy is doing press conferences. So Mike Pettine's kind of taken all the media, which is fine. That's part of being a head coach of a team. But I almost wonder, doesn't the buck have to fall there? And who else do you question when a team shows up that flat? Is he worried about too many other things and not doing the head coach thing enough? You know what I'm saying? Are there too many hats being worn by the head coach?
I think it's very likely that right now, certainly there are too many hats worn being worn by the head coach. I, like you say, I don't know the name of the assistant general manager.
Me neither.
If there is such a guy, and I know that I haven't seen Mr. Shiner doing press conferences. So you're right. That's all falling on Pettine right now, and that's too bad. And I am big on continuity, and you'd have to admire the organizations like the Steelers and others that promote from within, that have all this continuity year to year. But, you know, I got to say right now, I would not be the least bit upset if Jimmy Haslam decides to try to go out and bring in somebody, whether it's John Gruden or who it is, somebody with some kind of a track record in NFL football. And Gruden certainly has that, having taken a team and won a Super Bowl with them in a fairly short turnaround. And cleaning house, you know, I love continuity. I want to see it. But, man, right now, and I like Pettine too. But firing Pettine and Farmer and totally cleaning house right now would not be the worst thing to happen, in my opinion. I guess I'm getting there. I wasn't there 3 weeks ago, but I'm getting there.
I mean, to allow the squad to show up like this, this is the first, to me, if you're looking for a chink in the armor with me, this would be next year, if everything falls apart, I would go, it was after that Oakland game that was the first time that I said, wait a minute, I like this guy, but what the hell was that, man? I mean, he, and I'll give him credit. He doesn't dodge him and duck him. He stood right in front of it, and he looked downright embarrassed to talk about that game yesterday and say, hey, we stunk. We played like a scout team. And, you know, when he said that, I cringed for two reasons. I cringed because it's a terrible thing to hear your coach say about the description of his team's play. But I also cringed because he said it, because I'm like, man, that's almost a self-burying statement right there, even though you're being honest. You're being honest, but you're almost being honest to a fault there, because your owner just listened to you stand in front of the media and say, we just played like a Bush League team. And at the end of the day, you're the one that's responsible for that.
Exactly right. Yeah, it's your job to see to it that they don't. He hasn't been able to do that. And I don't know if Mike Pettine's in over his head. He's a likable guy, and I love the accountability, like you. No, you cringe because you don't want to hear your coach say that. You also cringe because it's true. And yes, they did. And, oh, by the way, that's your job. So it's frustrating. You know, this team could come out. And by the way, the San Diego Chargers are not a great team. You know, this is they got drilled yesterday. There's a good possibility that, you know, this team once again bounces back and goes out there and wins a game next week. Who the heck knows? The Ravens are 0-3. Is there any reason we should lie down for them? No. Things happen in the NFL and fortunes turn, and it's early in the season. But I am not optimistic about the long-term future of the team with the current administration in place. It's been an embarrassment ongoing, from the offensive line coach to the general manager being suspended to blowing the last five first-round draft picks in a row before Danny Shelton, at least. That's no way to run a franchise. You can't win when you can't draft. Most important player or person in the organization is the guy that picks the players. Ray Farmer hasn't shown me much in that regard.
Yeah, I mean, Larry's got a good point too. Great coaches are great motivators, and that is the one thing that you know, you can say. But if you're thinking one or the other, for those of you out there listening, you're going, well, I like Farmer, but not Pettin, or I like Pettin, but not Farmer. If anything is to get shaken up out of this season, it's first off, Mike Pettin is the most likely to go, because you don't traditionally dump. It's what already happened here. You don't traditionally force a new general manager to keep a coach that he didn't pick and that's not his guy, unless it's a long-term established winning coach that's been there for a while. So if you there is no replacing Ray Farmer and not Mike Pettin, in my opinion, just in the way it would work. If Farmer goes, Pettin's gonna go with him. If they want to keep Farmer may survive one more season and get a new coach. But to me, there's no way they'll both go before you'll see Farmer go and not Pettin. So if you like stability, you don't like to see it either way. But I'm with you, Dan, where you say it's starting to go. Let's see. There's tons of season left. I'm with you. I'm not that guy either. But you got San Diego here, and I'll tell you what. You think Keenan Allen's going to be any easier of a cover with the season that he's having so far than Amari Cooper or Brandon Marshall or any of the other wide receivers that seem to continually haunt the Browns? Because Keenan Allen, he's on three of my fantasy teams. I happen to know that he's having himself a heck of a season, Dan.
Yeah, you're right. And again, you look on our roster and you see zero of those guys. And,
what about that, Dan? So let's say that real quick. How about we're talking about the run and these other things on defense, which Mike Pettin's defenses have always, even going back years, been not good against the run traditionally. Let's talk about the pass defense and Quan Williams in the offseason comparing the Browns to the Seahawks secondary and making a blasphemous statement like that. This secondary has been toasted. Joe Hayden, again, I don't know where you are on Joe Hayden, but there's clearly a size level and a skill level where Joe Hayden gets passed by the bigger, stronger, more talented wide receivers. To me, he's a very good asset to your team, but again, shows why he could never be a good defense's number one.
Yeah, I'm inclined to agree that he's a good cornerback, not a great one. Certainly not a Pro Bowl level player in terms of the way that he's playing now. And let's face it, over the course of Joe Hayden's, what, six-year NFL career, the average NFL wide receiver, the number ones and number twos, the guy that your shutdown guy is supposed to guard, have gained 3 inches and 20 pounds.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and without losing any athleticism, in fact, probably getting more athletic on average across the league. So just like the play that won the game or that made the game close, I should say, last week against Tennessee with Dorial Green-Beckham going
well,
down the middle on fourth down
to
Marcus Mariota. As I said, you know, Mel Blount and Herb Adderley on their best days don't stop that reception from happening. It's a ball that's thrown 11 feet off the ground, and you've got a 6'5 guy getting up there to get it. And no cornerback stops that play. That's the value of having that QB that can make that throw and that big wide receiver that can make that play on the other end. So that's what we don't have. And I'm not blaming Joe Hayden for the fact that we don't have that guy.
No,
you know,
I'm with you.
I
he is undersized.
Don't disagree,
you know?
that Hayden's no longer a number one. He's certainly not a shutdown corner, and he hasn't played well. When he came back in the game after his injury yesterday, he was a shell of what he had been even before. He immediately came back in, missed a tackle on the sidelines, and the guy put 20 more yards on the play.
Yeah, we were joking. We said, oh, man, Amari Cooper hasn't been in the game plan for about 15 minutes. They saw Joe Hayden come back in and said, hey, let's throw it back over there to Amari Cooper again. And I'm with you. You just put it up in a way that a lot of people don't stated. So instead of going, Joe Hayden's garbage, Joe Hayden, no, I love the way you put it, because that's the truth of it. In the last few years, the average NFL wide receiver has grown exponentially in size. It's a measurable statistic, and that is the main reason that Joe Hayden has become less effective against the number one primarily wide receivers, because they're bigger and they're taller, and that's going to continue to hurt him. And unfortunately, that it is the way it is. Did you see that game last night, the Sunday night game? I was talking at the beginning. Man, they were doing a great job with camera work of zooming in on some of those one-on-one battles with Aqib Talib and Megatron.
Calvin Johnson,
and,
yeah.
Yeah, just some good stuff where you go, wow, that's really what it looks like when they're battling at a really high level.
Well, not only that, J-Rock, but, you know, it seems like every Sunday when I come back from a home Browns game,
then
and I
you
sit
go
down
watch
and,
that.
And watch the, and watch the 4 o'clock games, and then I watch the Sunday night game, and I think I'm watching a different sport.
A different sport, yes.
It
yes.
seems so often as if I'm watching an entirely different game. That's just, I'm used to it. So I hardly even notice it anymore because, like, oh, so this is what NFL teams are supposed to look like.
I agree. That was a heck of a game, by the way, there last night. Another good one. What did you think yesterday? By the way, let's get off the Browns for a second, because I know I've only got you for about another 10 minutes, and we'll talk some Buckeyes here in a minute. Around the rest of the NFL, though, what did you – man, how about A.J. Green yesterday, man, just getting loose for the Bengals? And there you got the Ravens. First time since they left Cleveland, 0-3 start. Couldn't happen to a better bunch of guys.
Yeah, that's true. Certainly not unhappy with that result, because I hate the Ravens, but gosh, they came back after not scoring.
Yeah, they did.
In the first half, and that 17 fourth quarter points. And I, you know, we're scoreboard watchers sitting there at the game, and I, you know, commenting with the people around us, hey, the Bengals are up, the Ravens are back up on top. And I guess I don't know how late the final game winning touchdown pass came in that game, but, the Bengals obviously played very well, and they're one of, what, five undefeated teams left in the NFL now.
You know what? Yesterday. Go ahead.
I was struck by a couple things. The Patriots hanging a half 100.
This is
really
the revenge
do.
Tour.
I mean, they look like you're 16-0.
I told you.
Might be coming true.
This is the revenge tour of the Patriots, my man. They are going to rip the league a new butthole. I'm telling you, man. They aren't playing around, man.
Yeah, that's right. I was a little bit surprised that the Jets, after going out 2-0, took a powder at home and fell behind big early the Eagles and ended up losing that game.
Yeah.
Not a whole lot of other surprising results. I was a little surprised the Vikings put it to the Chargers that convincingly. And then last night, or really in the 4 o'clock games, a couple of real blowouts, the Bills and the Cardinals, both looked very, very impressive. The Dolphins were, Dolphins are hurting. They haven't won a game, or they did win one game, 1-2, I guess. And then the Cardinals just waxing the 49ers again. Browns have the 49ers lead. They look like a shell of the teams that have been in the playoffs the last few years with Harbaugh. So
their defense is awful.
No shortage of surprises, but
the 49ers defense is absolutely awful, man. That's why I'm not too gung ho on the Cardinals yet. But man, when they've got Carson Palmer, they are a real deal. Larry Fitzgerald was making some big boy plays yesterday too,
Defense is very good. I mean, the Cardinals' defense, they've been playing extremely well, too.
Absolutely. Absolutely, man. But you've got a great point. And both of those teams on the Browns schedule later. You know, there was like three double-digit comebacks going on yesterday. The Colts, they were getting waxed by Tennessee. I think it was like 27-14, something like that. And they ended up winning 35-33 late. Luck was looking awful. He had like two picks, no touchdowns through three quarters or something. And how about the Dallas game? Dallas was up double digits, like two touchdowns on Atlanta.
Right. Falcons came storming back.
Yeah,
when
they scored 25 straight points. Julio Jones had a big day for them.
You know, we were sitting there at the Browns game talking about, looking at our smartphones,
looking
to see
at
what the numbers were. We see the Cowboys are up 28-7 or 28-10 or whatever. We say, oh my God, what, Whedon must be having a field day. And I looked it up at halftime. He was 13 out of 14,
yes,
for about 160 or so. And then I looked later and he was 19 out of 22. So obviously he still had a hot hand. He didn't have any touchdown passes because they were rushing the ball in
was
for
big, though.
Touchdowns.
His interception was a game swinger.
He did have a pick, I saw, but Yeah, we were looking, and of course, people were making a big deal out of, oh, Brandon Wheaton, he's doing better than our guy. You know, you hear this kind of talk from people at the game who are frustrated with what's going on the field. But anyway, yeah, Wheaton obviously couldn't stop the Falcons from scoring about three unanswered touchdowns there in the second half and beating the Cowboys. So they finally got a loss hung on them.
If any of you give me any – say Brandon Wheaton, I'll punch you in the throat. Get out of here. He first off, that interception that he threw was the because I saw the stats like you too, and I'm going, oh man, is Brandon Wheaton having a game? And then when I saw the game recap, the big play of the game, and it was Wheaton's interception that turned the momentum in the early part of it and started the swing. And I'm like, all right, cool. As long as the key play of the game was Brandon Wheaton's interception, I don't care what the rest of the stat line says. That's all I needed to see. Dan Wismar, Everybody Hates Cleveland. Let's wrap this thing up while we got a couple of minutes and talk about the Buckeyes. Friday, I was talking, kind of following up on your conversation with me that we had last week about this game with Western Michigan. I said, hey, I'm right there with what we said last week. 35 points is not happening. I do believe the Buckeyes win this game. I said by 24, they end up winning by 26. But I said, hey, take the points there if you can, because I don't see 35 points better than Western Michigan. Western Michigan's not going to put enough points on the board, but they're a decent squad over there, and they that was a good win for the Buckeyes, in my opinion.
Yeah, it was. The thing that was disconcerting to me was how they were able to run the ball on the Buckeyes with, you know,
right, and
with
they can't
great success.
Run.
They were right. Averaging 5-6 yards a pop really all day long. And that was distressing. The middle of the Buckeyes' defensive line at the tackles sort of been an area that they looked at as acknowledged as the thinnest position group on their roster. And I love this coach, P.J. Fleck, from Western. He, you know, young guy, 34 years old. He was a grad assistant at Ohio State, I believe, 7 or 8 years ago before he got his coaching start. And, boy, he's a guy to be reckoned with going forward. He had a great game plan. He kept that team in the game. If it wasn't for the defensive touchdown, you know, that's only a 17-6 game at halftime. And he's right in it. And he told his guys that at halftime. I don't know if you saw that before they came out for the second half, is that, you know, they had every opportunity and they basically shot themselves in the foot in the first half with a couple missed field goals and turning the ball over the one time. So they really, it should have been a closer game if they get even half a break. But again, Cardale had a good game. The wide receivers played better. The takeaways from the Buckeyes standpoint is Cardale really left a bunch of points on the board by underthrowing several deep balls. And I mean about four or five of them. A couple of them should have been touchdowns. He did have the one to Marshall that was a great throw. He throws the ball so effortlessly, and it seems like he's trying to aim it, maybe put a little bit too fine a touch on it, instead of just winging it out there and letting his guys run under it. There were several plays, I can think of four off the top of my head, that would have been touchdowns had the throws not been severely underthrown. That and the run defense is concerning, but that's kind of stuff they'll get worked out, and they start Big Ten play next week at Indiana, 4-0 Indiana, by the way.
Yeah.
Could be interesting.
You know what? With the run thing, I thought about that too, and I was going to pitch this to you as just kind of my thought on that whole thing is, you know, the running game of Western Michigan coming in was just nothing. They were clearly a passing team in general offensively heading into the game. And so I wondered if maybe that was just a function of, you know, a lot of times whatever you take away from teams, then they go the other way. And maybe since the Buckeyes had, you know, paid little concern to the rushing attack of Western Michigan, I thought maybe that may have been the reason for that, because I noticed that too. You know, perhaps you go, well, they're not going to beat us with the run, so you know, you clamp down a little bit less on that. I don't know, but overall, man, I'm with you. And now heading into Big Ten play here, the Buckeyes heading in undefeated, as you said. What are your thoughts? Well, you know, we can get more into it Wednesday and preview that, but definitely, you know, it's better than the alternative. And the beauty show continues as people continue to pick apart victories, 38-12, et cetera. But the quarterbacks, I'm with you. What was Cardale? 19-33, 288.
One quick question. One quick question, yeah. before you let me go.
Yeah.
It's seven games to go, and the Tribe, the 500 team. Are you playing taps yet for us, or where are you right now? You're hoping for seven straight wins.
You needed to get off here soon. There's a reason that we have not talked about the Indians yet in this conversation, because I thought if I brought them up, you may laugh at me at this point. Because
never.
The Indians are exactly where you say they are, man. Losing yesterday to me was probably the dagger. I mean, really, they were at a point where they needed to win out and still get some help. I mean, even now, if you win out, you get to 85. Has there ever been a playoff team at 85 wins before? Even if you get to that, I think it's a four is the number for elimination from Houston, and I think it's even lower from the other teams. So, I mean, you literally need Houston and Angels to go into a tank. You get the Twins one more time, so you can take care of that yourself. But you need those other teams to go in the tank, and you got to win out.
This was my sentiment yesterday. I feel so much better, so much more optimistic, and so much better about the future of the Cleveland Indians than I do about the Cleveland Browns, that it's not even close.
Amen.
The Indians had a miserable first 3 to 4 months of this season. Miserable, painful to their fans, frustrating. And yet, with everything that's happened in the last 2 months, with the starting pitching, I think that second half MVPs have to be Cody Anderson and Josh Tomlin, who give you starters number 5 and 6. That's the best thing that's happened the second half after Francisco Lindor. So I just feel great going forward with this team. Very, very optimistic, and it couldn't be more between how I feel about the future of the Cleveland Indians and how I feel about the future of the Cleveland Browns.
And that's
I'm going to have to fly.
That's an absolutely great point, and we can pick that up on Wednesday when you join us, Dan. We'll talk some more about that.
Sounds good, Jerry. I got to fly, but the good being with you as usual. You have a good one.
Talk to you Wednesday. My man, Dan Wismar, Everybody Hates Cleveland. Think about it, you guys. Baseball is such a long season that, you know, what Dan said there, you know, and you will, I think, maybe be able to appreciate that more. Maybe not. Maybe you're one of those cynical fans that just goes, the Dolans are cheap, and you stop watching after opening day or the first time the Indians, you know, have a bad open to the season like so many fans do. And I'm not saying that some of those feelings aren't deserved. I understand that, you guys. So many times the conversation has to be driven into black and white when there's tons of shades of gray in the middle of this thing. But look at how much of a disaster the first part of the Indian season was, really the first third of the Indian season was. And put that into counter with, like, the football team. Let's look at the Browns. You have an awful beginning of the season, right? Like a third would be, you know, you get through through the first five games of the season, which we're closing in on that point now. The difference is that at the end of a Browns season, we talk about this every year, and this is not a get on the Browns thing. This is you've got 75 starters injured, and you're signing guys off the street just to have enough guys to put into uniforms because it's gone from bad to worse. Never do you get the opposite. Even last season, it started good and went bad. Never do you get the opposite. I mean, can you imagine this Brown season, even if they do okay, even if they start to play better, could you imagine them by the end of this season doing better than they were doing at the beginning, like the Indians have done? That's what I'm saying. You may not realize it because it's been such a long season for the Tribe, but Dan just hit a great point. I damn sure feel better about where the Indians are than the Browns. I also feel better about where the Indians are than where they were after a month and a half into this season, too. But think about that. That's part of it, too. Even when you're having a bad season, it's seeing the improvement of things throughout and going, okay, this is what we've got to look forward to next year. Can you truly look at this season coming up and say, hey, I think we're going to get to that point with the Browns? I would hope so. I would damn sure hope so, because if not, there's going to be a whole rabbit hole to go down, and I do believe that these people will not survive this season. And I'm not telling you that I think that's a good thing. I'm just telling you that I think that's the thing that's going to happen at the rate this thing is going. San Diego, part of me says, hey, look at the egg they laid against Minnesota. Very winnable game. Road, not, whatever. And then the fact that they got talent. Philip Rivers can play some ball. If you don't think Philip Rivers can go out there and carve up this Browns defense, then I disagree, because he's got a good target in the wide receiver Keenan Allen that I mentioned earlier. And I do. Is this Gates back week or no? No, I think there's one more week, I believe, until Antonio Gates is back, because that's a big target there as well in the tight end game, as we know, and he's always been efficient against the Browns, that's for sure. We can talk more about it later. We're not looking ahead to next week, but, you know, that's a game that you have a chance in if you show up to play. If you don't, you don't have any chance in the world. There are some other games like that. Baltimore, you show up to play, you can beat Baltimore. Not because I'm saying that bragging-wise, not because I'm saying that all cocky. I'm just saying Baltimore's in some trouble this season, and losing Suggs really was a down thing for them here. It made their defense downgraded quite a bit, because he's that engine. He's like Mack was yesterday for the Raiders. He's all the leader of the ship there defensively for them, and they're having some trouble adjusting. And think about that. They've lost Nada, who they let go in free agency, and Suggs to injury. Those are two high-level, maybe Hall of Fame level, at least very, 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 very good level guys over the years out of that defense. That's the biggest problem with the Ravens right now. Baltimore, definitely a game if you show up, you got a chance in. San Francisco, wheels are falling off that bus there in the adjustment with Mike Tomsula's team there. So there's a few more. I'm telling you now, Seattle, forget about it. Cardinals, the way they're playing, forget about it. Broncos, forget about it. I mean, those are just hope your team don't show up and doesn't embarrass yourself games. But these other ones are still there. And that's the difference between how this season's going to end. It's either going to end 4-5 wins and you go, okay, they showed some pride and we don't have to fire anybody. Or they're going to finish 1-2 and whatever. And then heads will roll. Let's talk more about that with you. I'm going to open the phones when we come back. We'll go around the NFL. We'll talk Browns, Cavaliers, Tristan Thompson, Media Day, all of that. Let's do it when we come back, talking about the NFL, the Browns, the Buckeyes, the Tribe, the Cavs, and wrapping things up. 216-539-7535. 216-539-7535. Hit us up when we come back. Final segment of the Sports Fix and a ton more to go.
See you walking down the street. I say, don't worry, Sloopy girl, you belong to me. And so I say now, hang on, Sloopy, Sloopy, hang on. Hang on, Sloopy, Sloopy, hang on.
When it comes to Cleveland sports, we go from
"I can't touch this"
to
"I can't watch this."
So listen to The Fix. It's easier on the eyes.
Sports Fix listeners, like us on Facebook today. Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. Season at Harry Buffalo North Olmsted. And no matter who you root for, everyone wins at Harry Buffalo. Every Saturday is Coors Light College Football Saturday with $6 pitchers, four bottles for $10, and the Buckeyes in full HD. Every Sunday, all the Browns action with Bud Light beer specials and $10 Hair of the Dog pitchers.
Hey, baby, let's go out there like a bunch of crazy dogs and have some fun.
Plus, every Monday night, catch the Monday Night Football action with some of your favorite Browns players. Football season is most definitely party season, and your headquarters is Harry Buffalo North Olmsted all winter long. Harry Buffalo, join the herd. Fantasy sports lovers, you put so much time, hard work, and effort into playing week to week that it quickly stops being a fantasy and starts getting real. Real time spent making real decisions, creating real victory.
I'm the greatest man in the world!
And when the smoke clears, you want to show off those victories with a real prize.
I mean, a really real prize. Yeah.
Nobody does that like Fantasy Jocks. Beautiful, high-quality, and fantasy sports needs.
The trophy's 12 feet high, and it is glorious!
Football, baseball, hoops, you name it, they have it. Plus, they have awesome draft kits and party supplies to make all your preseason activities the envy of everyone. If your league needs a ring, but you already have, there's literally only one place to go. If you're going to be a fantasy jock, do it right.
It's mine, the most magnificent belt ever created, and it's mine.
With America's Fantasy Sports Superstore, FantasyJocks.com.
Hey, everybody. Listen up.
Listen up, guys.
Hey, guys.
Listen up.
No one should ever hit a woman.
Not their wife, not their girlfriend, not their date.
No woman should have to fear violence,
especially not from someone they know and trust.
But that's the reality for too many women.
We have to change it.
It's up to each of us, because even one is too many.
Violence against women hurts all of us. Growing up, I was ashamed and afraid of my father when he abused my mom.
The worst abuse of power is when a man raises his hand to hurt a woman. We all have to take responsibility. So if you see someone threatening a woman, step up, speak out, and get help.
Dating violence hurts all of us. So step up and help end it. Because one is too many.
One is too many.
One is too many.
One is too many.
End the violence.
Because it's wrong.
Because one is too many.
Portions of the Sports Fix brought to you by Fantasy Jocks. Looking to upgrade your league trophy? Check out FantasyJocks.com for championship belts, rings, trophies, and more.
Hey, Cleveland. This is Anderson Varejão of the Cleveland Cavaliers. You are listening to the Sports Fix.
Lamar for joining us from EverybodyHatesCleveland.com. Dan will be back in the house on Wednesday, and we'll have some time to sit and unwind and talk some Buckeyes, look ahead to the start of Big Ten play, look ahead to the Browns and the Chargers and so much more, talk about the Indians. Hey, can they go on a fantastic voyage? I don't know. I'm going to watch them. We'll see what they do with them. They start that run tonight. Final homestand. Is it 7 or is it 8? We'll find out if they need that 8th game when it comes to that point. Anyways, welcome back into the show. I've got some calls here. 216-539-7535. Facebook.com/TheSportsFix. Twitter at TheSportsFix. CLE. Email us. TheSportsFix@AOL.com. Heard Anderson Varejão there. Tristan Thompson. He's not there at Cavaliers Media Day. Cavaliers meeting with the media today before they kick off training camp officially tomorrow, and the defense of their Eastern Conference championship and their attempt to finish it all and climb the trophy and win the entire shebang as they look to become the NBA champions. They're being given 2-1 odds in the Vegas sports books, the highest in the NBA to begin this season. And we'll see the drama this week. Involving Tristan Thompson and the Cavaliers should come to a head one way or another. The Cavs have until Thursday to wrap this thing up. It's either going to be 1 year, $7 million, $6.9 million qualifying offer, and that's the one that Tristan says if it comes to that, he's going to take a walk next year. And to me, I mean, listen, it's a big risk to take in yourself. And I'll be interested to see the dynamic if Tristan Thompson does it. Because basically, and by the way, word coming out of Cleveland that the Tristan Thompson camp offered the Cavs that three-year, $53 million compromise that the Cavaliers apparently were not interested in over the weekend. I still think that's going to be the likely landing point of this thing, but it's a big risk if you're Tristan Thompson. To play next year for $7 million. Not the risk is not to play for $7 million. Don't make me sound foolish. The risk is that you're walking away from a guaranteed nearly $90 million that you could sign right now with the Cavaliers in exchange for that. You get hurt, and then all of a sudden you've got a whole different scenario. So you got to have a lot of belief in yourself and a lot of faith in a higher power to make that offer. But Thursday is the drop-dead date, so we'll see. Tristan Thompson probably going to hold out tomorrow. It wouldn't surprise me at all if he tries to put the screws one last time to the Cavs, and maybe that'll be the final thing. Maybe they'll say, okay, let's get this thing over with. We don't need any distractions, anything, as we head into what should be a big key fun season here for the Cavs with so many things that they've got on their list of things they want to get accomplished this season. Of course, ending with a championship. Thursday is the date. So we'll see here as we watch, and we'll see what they go out there and do. And we'll be talking about it here tomorrow. Media day kicks off, or tomorrow the practice kicks off. Today, media day over there at the courts for the Cleveland Cavaliers. Hey, guys, I'm going to go to the phones here in just a moment. We're talking some NFL and some Browns all day today with Dan, with you guys, as I know a lot of people's takes coming in on the social media. Some good, mostly bad. And you know what? A conversation that we can get into on the next episode of the show here when Dan joins us with something that I alluded to earlier, which is the what do you do at quarterback for the Browns going forward. And here's my thing, and this is why I can kind of give a little bit of credence to that question, because of what we said earlier. Doesn't matter if Superman is the quarterback of this Browns team, as long as they're going to play in every other position the way they've played two out of the three games so far. And that's two out of three. There's still 13 left to play. You guys want to be men, turn around. Hey, anybody can turn the narrative around, man. That doesn't just mean winning and losing. You can go out there and play with some heart, play with some testicular fortitude. But regardless, if the bottom line is that you're going to have the exact same record no matter who the quarterback is, because I can get, if we're talking about the difference between one quarterback's going to win three games and one's going to win seven. Okay, that's a big difference. That's a big difference, you know? That's something to argue that you don't want to make the fans sit through, you know, 3-13 when they can sit through 7-9. But when that's not the conversation, and now we're going, well, you're going to be 1-15, and I didn't say this, but I'm just saying, if that's the truth, if it gets to the point that that's going to be it no matter what, then I do believe that at that point, you throw the kid out there, whether it's for 10 games, 12 games, 14 games, whatever it is that's left, you throw him out there and let it be. Because you're not going to win any more games. He's not going to cost you any games that you would have won. And if that's the case, then throw the kid out there, because you can go ahead and figure out once and for all whether the kid's going to sink or swim. That's fine. And I don't have a problem with that. I don't have some undying loyalty to Josh McCown, etc. So let's see how they play next week. You go out there and lay an egg, not lose. You go out there and lay an egg again next week, then I'm all for that conversation. Because again, and some people will say it's foolish anyway. What's the difference between three wins and seven wins? I say quite a big difference. Quite a big. Matter of fact, that's a whole month of crappy sports talk that you got to sit through when you lose four games. That's they only play one of these things a week, so that's 30 days of that crap that you can save yourself from. But I get that argument too. And I also go back to, there may be a reason why they haven't gone that way either. And besides, say what you will, maybe he might have hit one long pass yesterday or whatever, but Khalil Mack would have de-cleated him one or two times and he probably would have ended up fumbling the ball. But we can talk about this, because I mentioned to Dan that I want to bring it up on Wednesday, and I'm curious for you guys the next couple of days. Hit me up on the social media and let me know your thoughts, because even if you're a hardcore, hey, start man or don't start Manziel, start McCown guy, what is your drop-off point? Is it halfway through the season? Or is it that just whatever point you realize that he can come down from on high and sit at the right side of the throne and play quarterback, and even the highest of the high couldn't do much to lead this team offensively this season? Then you got to have that conversation. Are we there yet? I don't know. I'm going to go to the phones and see where you're at here. Caller, you're up on the Sports Fix. As soon as I turn you up, there we go. Caller, you're up on the Sports Fix.
J-Rock Daddy.
LG Daddy. What's up, man?
Okay. Uh-oh. Let me talk.
He's all low-key, man. This is like the Godfather's got some things to say now. All right, go ahead.
Let me talk, because this is the best voice I have left.
Oh, from yelling at the TV yesterday?
You got it, J-Rock Daddy. But I'm not even exaggerating. This is the best voice I got left. But let's talk about a couple of things I heard you talking about earlier. How much you like Mike Pettine as a head coach, and one of the guys you brought up that you liked as a former head coach of the Cleveland Browns was Marty Schottenheimer.
Yeah.
Well, Marty Schottenheimer was a football coach, J-Rock Daddy. Mr. Patton is not a football coach. He's an emotionalist guy that stands on the sidelines and tries to figure out mentally what went wrong with his football team. He shows more motivation in his coaching abilities, and he shows no motivation to the troops. If Marty Schottenheimer was standing on the sidelines of the Cleveland Browns and we saw some of the shenanigans taking place that we saw yesterday, clipboards would be flying. His glasses would be flying off his face. He'd be screaming and yelling at somebody, trying to motivate these guys. Now, you know, from last week when I talked to you, I said one big thing is if the Browns defense can show up 2 weeks in a row. And that's where the motivation factor comes in, J-Rock Daddy. If you can't motivate your men, then what we're going to see is flat football every other week. You have to be able to motivate your men to be on high game after game after game. After all, there's only 16 games in a football season.
And Larry, so that's the point I want to make. Let me jump in there. Let me jump in on your point right there, because I agree with you. And there's something to be said for that, because I don't believe that the Browns are as bad on defense as they looked in week one and week three. I damn sure don't believe they're as good as they looked in week two either. Obviously, there's a middle ground. But to me, that weekly up and down is an issue with the coaching. And I don't know if it's Mike Pettine, if it's the secondary coaching, the third level of coaching. I don't know where it is. But it's like you said, you want that even consistent effort from week to week where you know what you're going to get. Through three games in this season, nobody could tell me what Cleveland Browns is going to show up on Sunday to play the San Diego Chargers, because you've got literally blatant examples in each direction and the other of the opposite. But it's that up and down. It's that, and the Browns, since 99, have consistently never been able to follow up on the good, and that seems to be a problem. Whether you, again, want to blame the coaching staff higher on the food chain, lower on the food chain, maybe it's the mentality of the type of players that you have, but there are certain people that have a small amount of success and they get complacent, and that's what the Browns remind me of. Even when they have a good game, it's almost always over the years followed up by a down game, and then maybe they get back up again and then down. Very rarely do you get two, and hardly ever do you get three consecutive consistent efforts. And that's something to be said about that right there, because you're, and that's a time, think about it, when you're young and you're immature in your life, there were probably times that you were doing good at your job and you were making some good money and you were like, yeah, and you were blowing some cheese and you were feeling good about life and you're like, yeah, man, I'm jamming pretty good. And then, you know, you stumble because you didn't see it coming, because you were too busy, you know, up on this level and paying attention to the wrong stuff. And next thing you know, you're down again. But when you get older, all of a sudden, your life doesn't have those huge ups and downs. Like, you're not on top of the world for 6 months and then, oh, man, everything's going wrong for 3 months and now I got it back. You don't have those ebbs and flows when you get older, because you're mature and you learn how to stay an even keel. These guys have never been able to do that. They never follow up one effort with a consistent second effort.
J-Rock, it all goes back to coaching.
Yeah.
And the reason I keep bringing up coaching, because you remember in the 80s when we had Bernie Kosar and Marty Schottenheimer, and the Cleveland Browns were a contender year after year after year. I mean, geez, we just missed going to the Super Bowl a couple of times with Kosar leading the pack. And you can have an argument that Kosar wasn't the most physically gifted quarterback in the NFL, and he wasn't. But mentally, he was tough. That mental toughness is what keeps the Cleveland Browns in a football game. Marty Schottenheimer's ability to lead and ability to bring out the best in every single player. Same thing goes back to a guy like Sam Ritigliano. Mr. Ritigliano could take what a guy had and show that guy how to use it. And he may not be the most gifted athlete out there in the field, but he was able to get the most out of the package that he had. Now, J-Rock, what we do have to remember, this is where this conversation gets a little hairy. The grave mistake that Cleveland made goes back to the Lerner family. Selling this team to Jimmy Haslam has just put the poison cross marks on the label of the Cleveland Browns, I think. And the reason I'm saying that, J-Rock Daddy, we settled on Mike Pettine. All the good coaches we tried to get refused to come here. Mike Pettine's a guy that settled on coming and getting a chance to be an NFL head coach. Because he lacks the motivation factor, I don't think he's head coaching material. Is he a likable guy? Heck yeah. Does he answer to the media? Heck yeah. But he's not a motivator of men that this Cleveland Browns football team needs. And we're going to have a hard time trying to get that because of the business model Jimmy Haslam painted. I'll go back to the Pilot Flying J fiasco, where 9 of the top-level executives that worked for Jimmy Haslam were thrown under the bus so Jimmy Haslam could save his own butt during all the legal hassles. 9 guys faced jail time, J-Rock Day. Now, do you want to work for a guy that's going to throw you under the bus the first chance he gets to save his own butt?
No, and I hear you. But you know what? I got to go back to part of what you're saying, too, because I disagree in a way, because you were... I mean, and I know your opinions change on people and stuff, but you were in the support camp here of Mike Pettine for quite. I mean, last year, I don't remember anybody saying that Mike Pettine couldn't motivate his guys and get them going. Actually, that was one of the stuff was being a motivational guy and getting his guys fired up. So I don't agree with that part of it per se. And to be honest with you. I think you're wrong when you say that the poison pen was selling the Browns to the to Jimmy Haslam. The ink was in the well way before that. If anything, the sale of the Browns from the Lerners was the franchise's one opportunity to pull itself out of the hole of who cares that they had sunk into since 1999 because they were just somebody's tax abatement. They weren't actually anybody's passion to correctly turn around. They were a bunch of people's free paycheck. And I'll continue to say that in 2012, the Browns had the opportunity. They had the right owner with the right resources and the right chance to turn the ship around. Turned out that the mentality of the owner is the wrong guy, it turns out, because there it is. But I agree with Bruce. That was where I was going. The poison was set in stone from the moment that this ill-fated return was put together in 1999. The problem is that 16 years later, you can't keep pointing the finger at the NFL because while the NFL may have screwed the Browns 16 years ago in the way we started and all of that, there's a whole lot of bad franchises that have fixed themselves in the last 16 years, and we still haven't. So, at the end of the day, somebody's J-Rock. Not doing their job right.
J-Rock, Daddy, in the history of watching football and standing back and looking at the inner workings of an NFL football team, I'll be the first one to tell you, I've never seen so many first-round draft picks come and go on a franchise in my entire life.
That's the key. The key.
You have guys.
LG. More than the coaches, more than the general managers, what you just said is the key. This team has fumbled its draft since 1999, and the draft is the lifeblood of the NFL. Not just good teams, every team. Those are the players that put on the field and play the freaking game. And the Browns literally have entire draft classes that 2-3 years later don't play in the NFL. There's no franchise that could do that right now. I don't care. Whoever's your favorite franchise, if it's the Seattle Seahawks, you let the Seahawks go 0 for the next 2 drafts, and in 3-4 years, you're looking at one of the worst teams in the NFL, I guarantee it.
And J-Rock, you still there?
Mm-hmm.
The bottom line is the assessment of who you're drafting, and that comes from the football operations, whether it be the coaching staff having their little meetings, the assessment of proper talent. You know, I'm not going to cry it over spilled milk, but you have a Sammy Watkins who could be hailed as a playmaker.
You know, let's not do it. I don't want to beat myself in the face. Let's not do it.
I'm not going to beat myself in the face either, but I'm saying it's bad assessment of talent, J.
Absolutely.
You need to surround. You know what? A guy told me a long time ago, you don't have to know crap about owning the business as long as you surrounded yourself with people
with
that
people
knew
that
do.
Business. Yes, yes.
And I hate to say this. You got a first-year GM in, well, it's a second year now, but with Ray Farmer.
Right.
You got a head coach who's never been a head coach, and the first thing he does is hire his friend from Buffalo to be the defensive coordinator. You got a offensive coordinator who doesn't really have that much experience, and I'm not a Kyle Shanahan lover by any sense of the means, but when you had a guy like Shanahan who some people tout him as being one of the best offensive
I don't.
In the game.
I want to jump in there. I like Shanahan.
I don't.
But he's nothing super special. But it does. I don't like the way the Browns let him walk for nothing. Just because. Well, if he don't want to be here. Well, the reason that he don't want to be here is what's wrong with the Cleveland Browns. Whether you like Shanahan or not, that's what was wrong with the Cleveland Browns. The fact that there was an atmosphere where the offensive coordinator had to debate what kind of plays he was calling for Johnny Manziel because he didn't want the guy playing football. And when you had that whole toxic atmosphere that we talked about, that was the problem, even though I don't think Kyle Shanahan's the greatest. But, Larry, forget the offensive coordinator.
Either. I don't
because
think he's the greatest.
Even if it's Steve Filippo, it doesn't matter. We know this offense sucks. It was built to barely be good enough to win in the NFL. Their whole game plan was, we're winning this thing, running the ball in the trenches, and stopping you on defense. And so I don't even think it's fair to even say anything on the offensive side of the ball, because I'll go back to, if this team averages 20 points for the season offensively, to me, that's exactly what you expected them to do. Anything more than that is a miracle, and you're getting more than what you paid for. The problem is on the other side of the ball. This is a defense that touted themselves as a top 10 defense, and they have been anything but most of the time.
And J-Rock, that's where Mike Pettine's pedigree comes from.
I know.
The defensive
that's
side
the
of the football.
That's the part that gets me.
And,
I agree.
And what we're seeing in a game like yesterday and in a game like the first game of the season, you remember our talk after the first
yes.
game?
Yes.
I was completely disgusted that this was the defense that we were told was going to be so outstanding that was on the field in game one. Now, what I want to tell you is, if you've got a guy, you know, let's just say you forget about the offense completely, being a defensive-minded head coach, and you let the offensive guy take care of that end of the football. You concentrate on the defense, and like you said, and like your guest minutes ago said, this was an embarrassment. He was embarrassed to be sitting in that stadium watching the Cleveland Browns football. And you know what, J-Rock? This is a week where I'm seeing a lot of comments on social media of people that do travel week in and week out to go to these home games from distant places like Columbus or Cincinnati or anywhere in Southern Ohio, and they're done. They're done. They're saying, that's it. I can't do it anymore. I'm wasting too much time and too much money to go sit and watch this garbage that this organization is putting on a football field. Now, in 16 years, let's just say this. In 16 years, yeah, there's been mistakes made, J-Rock Daddy, but if you would have surrounded yourself with an organization that had people in place that understood how to build an NFL quality organization and you didn't micromanage, you know, that's Haslam's like a Jerry Jones, kind of guy. He's got to have his hands in the pie. And oftentimes people said Jerry Jones should keep his hands just writing the checks.
I disagree with that, though. Jerry Jones has now been hands-on for 20, what, how long has he been now? What, since 1989 he took over that team? So,
right.
I mean, that's a
but
long time.
But at least
time.
This guy.
But he's got 20 years around the NFL game. I don't think Jerry Jones is the greatest general manager. Don't get me wrong. But Jerry Jones, right. He at least made the buck stop with Jerry Jones. He said, "The hell with this. I'm gonna pick the players. I'm paying for them, and it's my investment." And I give him credit. He built his own stadium. He picks his own players. And I'll tell you what. Even with Romo and Dez Bryant's injuries, I do believe that this is a good year for the Cowboys coming up. I thought before he got hurt, I thought Tony Romo was going to be the MVP of the NFL this year. I do believe that for as much as people want to, I think that's a five-year-old narrative when people say, "Oh, Jerry Jones is a meddling owner." I say, no, actually, it took him a while to back off and figure out football and let some of his football people tell him things that he didn't want to listen to.
But I'm using him as a comparison.
He's decent. No, I know. But what I'm saying is Jerry Jones is getting better at what he does, and the Cowboys are a good team down there in Dallas, man.
And Jimmy Haslam is by far no Jerry Jones.
No, because he doesn't have 20 years of football experience to allow himself to at least have some seat at the table in the conversation. And I don't know that he necessarily does as much as it does. You don't have to be involved in every decision. I don't think Jimmy Haslam micromanages the team. I don't believe that he's the kind of guy, because no billionaire micromanages that kind of stuff. There's definitely people who, that's your department, and you handle that. I don't think he handles X's and O's. I don't think he's not texting Ray Farmer after every play in the game. That being said, I do believe that he puts his thumb down on the important things to him, including who is the highly acided quarterback that we've invested in that we want in our team, things like that. So just because you only meddle in the importance, that's what I think Jimmy Haslam does. He puts his thumb down in one or two important matters rather than micromanaging every single detail. I don't think he does that, because
I'm not so sure that anybody in an NFL franchise could micromanage every single detail.
Yeah, I don't think he can. There's too much
not
stuff.
Not even Jerry Jones, who has 20 years of football experience. But what I'm saying is, even to consider micromanaging any aspect of the team, when you're so green to it yourself, that's where you need to surround yourself with people.
Give yourself the
opportunity to hire great people.
I'm not saying you or me or any of us out here could turn the Browns around overnight. I'm not in any way saying that. But I can tell you that I've done it in 16 years. In 16 years, I'd have figured it out. I may have given y'all some bad football teams for the first couple, and I may have had to figure my job out. And that's the problem, is that nobody's been given 16 years. Most of them, I'll bet you the average general manager since 1999. This is a good project for Wednesday's show. If any of you guys want to do the work, go look up every general manager since 99 and every head coach, and then look at how long they had their job and divide it by the total number of however many, and let me know what the average was, because I'm willing to bet the average general manager has only lasted two seasons in Cleveland, and the average head coach probably about the same, maybe a season and a half, because Judd's going to bring the average down a little bit because he only had one season there. But I bet you it's going to be between one and two for each
now,
of them.
Just because of that, just because of that example, let's just say that the Browns have a miserable football season this year. And let's just say they have a hard time winning another football game.
I know where you're going. I don't know, man. I don't know.
I really can't. I can't see them beating San Diego. I tell you right now, they're going to face a pissed-off Baltimore Ravens team coming in. You know, who knows what's going to happen with the Ravens next week, but coming in with three losses already. I don't see the Browns. Then you got the Denver Broncos. And then the
Ravens. I know, Larry. We know what's coming up, man. There's a murderer's row on this schedule, man. We'll get into all that here.
But let's just say that we have a losing season and Jimmy Haslam cleans house again. Who in their right mind are we going to be able to hire,
Larry,
that can come in and do any better than the people that are in place now?
Larry, I don't know. I
got
to be honest. I'm wrapping this up with this. I don't know the answer to that question, and I'm not trying to figure it out on September 28th. I'm not even going there yet. You know what happened today? Cavaliers started training camp today. I'm done with this, Larry. What do you got to say about that? The Cavaliers started training camp, baby.
Well, I thought the Cleveland Cavaliers story.
Let's end this with something you're excited about, man.
You know, what a fantastic season it was last year.
You're breaking up bad, Larry. I don't know if it's on my end or
your end. I hate to make early predictions, J-Rack Daddy, but I really feel that this could be their season, man. And with some of the moves they made, it's still up in the air what's going to happen with Tristan. But I got to tell you, we got a healthy Varejo coming back. Hopefully he can stay healthy for a while, because you know that guy's a mad dog out there on the floor. Nobody fights harder for a rebound than Anderson Varejo. He gets a chance this season to play with LeBron James. I mean, I tell you what, it's going to be some exciting Cleveland Cavalier basketball. Now, the other end of the spectrum is it's a long season. What is it, 82 games, J-Rack?
Oh, yeah.
You know, we got to pray for healthy players because we saw last season what health cost this Cleveland Cavaliers team. We should be in good shape with Kyrie being healthy. But the longevity of the season and the battles that take place, and if we would have had one more healthy player last year, J-Rock Daddy, I believe we would have brought that championship NBA trophy back to the Cleveland Cavaliers last year. One more healthy body, that's all we needed. You can't put it all on LeBron. So,
well, guess what, they added three new healthy bodies to the exact same squad that they had last year. And to me, that's the biggest difference, is take last year's team and add Mo Williams, Richard Jefferson, and Sasha Kahn to the grouping that you now have. One extra guard, one extra forward, and one extra center. They have added depth at every position. They are truly ready to protect themselves for this championship run. That much you can feel good about.
The excitement Mo Williams has to be feeling to come back into a Woo-hoo! Cleveland Cavaliers uniform and play with the lineup that he's going to
and
be
I
playing
love it. You guys know Mo Williams is my favorite Cavalier of the modern Cavalier era. I loved Mo Williams while he was here, and the Thundercats are reunited, baby. I love it, man. Mo Williams.
Yeah, I really think I think Mo. I always liked Mo myself, J-Rock, and I got to tell you, like I'm saying, to bring this guy back in and put him in a Cavs uniform with this lineup, are you kidding
That's
me?
That's what
man?
I'm saying. And you know what jersey he's wearing? 52, because he put up 52 points last year. So it's a fresh start for him, and he's busting out that number 52. Larry, I'm up against it, my man. I got to roll. Let's talk on Wednesday.
All right, J-Rock Daddy. I'll talk to you hopefully next day.
You got it. My man, LG, breaking up bad there at the end. LG from Cleveland Sports 360. Hey, guys, we've got tons to get into. Today was, the breakdown of the Cleveland Browns and their game here, and we've got to flip the focus and turn the page. When we come back on Wednesday, we'll talk some Browns, but we'll look back and look ahead to the Chargers coming up here. There's a lot of weapons there. If you think this is going to be, hey, just because they're coming off of a tough one, they're going to be looking to fix their ship too, and they've got quite a bit of weapons, including one of the most experienced and better quarterbacks in the NFL. I'm a Phillip Rivers fan. I don't know about you. I think he's a great quarterback. I mean, I'm one of those guys that is in the corner of one Phillip Rivers when it comes to rating the quarterbacks around the NFL. So he's got some weapons there too. You got Gordon and got some backs coming out of the backfield. You got obviously Keenan Allen. We'll talk about all that. We're going to talk Browns. Buckeyes will preview the start of Big Ten play. Dan Wismar is going to be here from Everybody Hates Cleveland. Cavaliers camp officially underway. Maybe we'll have a finale here and a decision on what goes down with Tristan Thompson when Dan's here. We'll be talking about all of that. The Indians kicking off the final homestand of the season. You got the Minnesota Twins here, and the Indians and the Twins are playing four games at Progressive Field, and the Indians need to win all four of these, plus the four that are left over, and hope that a whole bunch of other people do what they need them to do as well. Phil Hughes and Corey Kluber, Kyle Gibson and Cody Anderson, Mike Pelfrey and Carlos Carrasco, Tyler Duffy and Josh Tomlin, the four-game set for the Indians here. We'll be back on Wednesday in the middle of this, and we'll see where they're at. They took two or three from the Royals over the weekend. Really needed to take all three just to keep this conversation even even in the ether. It is what it is. They've got to win them all and then hope for some help. I'm hoping for it, and I'll be watching them too tonight. Let's see what happens. Corey Kluber trying to get back off the schneid since the – it hasn't been the same since he came off the disabled list. Hopefully he can get started on that. Phil Hughes is a good matchup as well with Kluber. We'll see what happens with the Tribe. We'll talk some Buckeyes and Browns and Monday Night Football tonight, by the way, if that's your thing. Green Bay, Kansas City. I'm just going to tell you, I think that's going to be a tighter game than some people think. Kansas City can play some ball. Let's see if they can stop Green Bay from going 3-0. I don't know that I'm going to pick Kansas City to win, but I am going to pick Kansas City to make it a hell of a game. And I got Green Bay, but I've got Green Bay in a close one. So that means Packers in a blowout for those of you voting at home. We'll see. It's fresh out of Washington as we wrap things up. The Nationals suspend Jonathan Papelbon 4 games for going after the fight in the Bryce Harper situation there. And I don't know if you guys saw that or not, but they got into it in the dugout, some choking and some rumbling in the dugout going on, an embarrassing environment. The frustration of the whole season in Washington, they were World Series favorites, and it's really kind of blown up there. Hey! When you guys are ready to ditch Harper for prospects, let us know. We'll talk to you here in Cleveland. We got some prospects if you guys are ready to part ways with that Harper kid. I hear he's got some potential. We'll gladly talk to you about that. LeBron says Kevin Love this year is going to let me get a lot of rest because of his abilities and what he's able to do. I agree. We'll talk about that on Wednesday, the Thoughts of Media Day, the kickoff of camp, all of that. Browns, Buckeyes, Tribe, Cavs, your take, BJ Riddell, Fantasy Football for Winners, Dan Wismar, Everybody Hates Cleveland, and you, baby, right here, live, noon, same bat time, same bat channel, Wednesday. Across the Sports Fix Radio Network. We love you, Cleveland and beyond. Enjoy football. Enjoy your beginning of the media day. No preseason games just yet. That's about 2 weeks from now. But the training camp has begun. Enjoy your Tribe baseball. And get back here Wednesday. And let's do the thing. Noon. Right here. On the Sports Fix. Kiss the cardiac, rock car, science in the Tower City, all of that. Warehouse district, Euclid corridor, and all the flat. You know that I'm a Tribes fan, and I love slimings. Crockett Park's the perfect place for me to spend some time in. Baby, this is Cleveland. It is so much more to us. You can even go to Severance Hall to see an orchestra. In Cleveland, we rep our city. Yeah. Blue lights separate the grime from the gritty. We're 6 minutes, hood class cover, and it's